When you go outside today, what's the first thing you notice? The sound of songbirds, trees all around you, the grass under your feet? We'll now try to imagine a world before all of that. In this video, I will be talking about the first animals on Earth, when they evolved, where they evolved, what they were like, and how they set the stage for the Cambrian explosion, or the evolution of modern animal life. Before we jump right into the video, if you like my Geology Rocks shirt that I'm wearing right now, you can check it out at my merch website, which I'll link in the description box below. I just updated the clothes section of the website with a bunch of new designs, so the shirts, the hoodies, the crewnecks, and you can check those out if you want to be as cool as me and rock a bunch of geology-related and crinoid and foraminifera-type sweatshirts and shirts. And with that, we'll get back to the video. So just to set the stage in terms of geological history, or the lifetime of Earth per se, most of Earth's history, around 90% of it, or nearly 90% of it, was dominated by microbial life. That is, tiny micro single-celled organisms that were not by any means animals or plants or anything large that we see with the naked eye today. So honestly, if we think about it, the world that we know, the songbirds that we hear, the trees that we see, the grass that we walk on, is only a very recent world in terms of Earth's entire history. For most of Earth's duration of existence, this was not the norm. Also, for your reference, just to be able to read this timescale, it goes from the beginning of Earth's formation around 4.55 billion years ago at the beginning of the Hadean Aeon, and then the first kind of more robust evidence for life is around 3.5 billion years ago, and of course that was microbial, which obviously dominated Earth life until animals and larger multicellular organisms and algae and fungi and eventually plants evolved. And the animals is what we'll be focusing on in today's video, but this range shows kind of the rough range that we think animals evolved in, which goes from all the way back to 900 million year ago estimates to obviously the Cambrian explosion, which occurred around 539 million years ago. And we'll talk more about those really old estimates later in the video. So one of the biggest things I have to emphasize right up front in this video is that, yes, the Cambrian explosion for a long time was thought to be the first appearance of animals in the rock record, and thus the first appearance of animals on Earth, period, around 539 million years ago. However, now we know that there were animals, large multicellular ones, before the Cambrian explosion. And as many of my audience, I'm sure, already knows, especially because you guys asked me to make a video about them, these are called the Ediacaran fauna, or Ediacaran biota. However, as I'll get to later in the video, the Ediacaran fauna might not have even been the very first animals, and we'll get back to that. But before we jump into that, the reason that the Cambrian explosion around 539 million years ago seems like an explosion of life in the rock record is mainly because of the rapid proliferation of hard parts at that time. That is, the rapid adaptation of skeletons and shells and other harder materials made by life that were more likely to get preserved in the rock record. But Ediacaran biota, as many of you know, which evolved earlier around 635 million years ago up until the Cambrian explosion, were these tubular and frond-shaped, mostly sessile and soft-bodied organisms. That is, organisms that were attached to the seafloor and lacked hard parts. They lacked skeletons and shells, which is why they were so hard to find in the rock record for so long. Things that don't have hard parts don't get preserved as often because the organic material that they're made with gets decomposed. That said, we do have some spectacular preservations of Ediacaran fauna that are imprints that we've learned a lot from, but it's limited because you can only learn so much from an imprint of an organism. What we do know is that these were potentially the earliest animal ecosystems. Yes, there may have been early animals that evolved before 635 million years ago or before the Ediacaran period. However, we still think that in terms of large multicellular animal ecosystems, the Ediacaran is the first appearance of these relatively complex ecosystems relative to prior to this, not relative to now. Relative to now, these were very simple ecosystems, but for the time, they seem to be the first relatively complex animal ecosystems, and this we call the Avalon Explosion. However, there's still a lot of questions regarding these first animal ecosystems. For example, were these even the first animals? How do we know? And if so, if they are animals, are they direct ancestors to modern animal groups? And if so, which ones? Or were they rather a failed animal-like experiment or evolutionary experiment that gave way to more successful groups in the Cambrian, that is, the actual animals? Most modern animal body plans, or body plans more similar to animals that we see today, like sponges, cnidaria, corals and jellies, arthropods, things like trilobites in the Cambrian, and things like lobsters and other crustaceans today, echinoderms, crinoids, which have been around essentially since the Cambrian and still live today, mollusks, things like clams, snails, etc. All of these modern type body plans first appeared in the Cambrian period, after the Ediacaran. And we can see in the rock record, the Cambrian life almost completely replaced Ediacaran life, but their relationships are still debated. Ediacaran fauna are so enigmatic that they've been classified as so many different things. Animals, lichens, algae, protists, fungi, microbial colonies, or even hypothetical plant-animal intermediates. Here are some pictures of Ediacaran fauna, their fossils, and their reconstructions, meaning what they might have looked like during life. Dickinsonia fossils have been found with sterol molecules that indicate a potential relationship to animals. So, of all of those classifications I just mentioned, this kind of leans toward the hypothesis of Ediacaran biota being animals, or at least being animal ancestors of some kind. And if you want to learn more about how we can use biomarkers like sterol molecules to group ancient fossil organisms into different taxonomic or biological categories or groups, you can check out my How We Reconstruct Earth's Past video. I have a whole section about biological proxies, or things called biomarkers and biosignatures that we can use to further understand the biology that we find in the rock record. But that aside, even if Dickinsonia and other Ediacaran biota were animals, does that mean that they were direct ancestors of modern animal phyla or modern animal groups like sponges, cnidaria, mollusks, arthropods, all the ones we talked about earlier? Or were they a separate failed phylum or group that is not directly related to any of the modern groups? Well, it's hard to tell because their morphologies can convergently evolve in different lineages. A few examples of Ediacaran biota are shown on the left here. We've got Springina, an early bilaterian, meaning that it has bilateral symmetry. And then we also have another one over here with bilateral symmetry that I don't know how to pronounce, Parvincorina. We're gonna go with that. And this one, as well as Yorgia at the bottom here, which does not have bilateral symmetry, it does have some asymmetry, but does look similar to these other groups. We can see with all three of these groups that they look somewhat similar in terms of their body plan or morphologies. And that brings up a question of whether these groups evolved separately and just happened to look alike because those body plans were beneficial for the time, or if they are genetically related. These are kinds of questions that we can answer with modern animals because we can look into their genetics. We can't do that when we just have the rock record. The closest we can get is biomarkers like sterol molecules, which indicate a relationship to animals. But that doesn't typically get us to a specific enough taxonomic level to say whether different groups of animals are related. Moreover, not only does this type of similar morphology seem to repeat itself in Ediacaran biota alone, but it also repeats itself later with the evolution of our friend the trilobite. I know all of my audience is familiar with and loves trilobites. I have multiple videos about them, and we love them. They're great. I have them on multiple shirts that I own. However, trilobites did not evolve until the Cambrian, and so does that mean that they evolved from these earlier similar looking organisms from the Ediacaran period, or does that mean that they just re-evolved the same morphology as those earlier groups, but completely as a separate lineage due to what we call convergent evolution? Well, again, we don't know, and this is why I bring this example up. It's really difficult to tell between the Ediacaran fauna and the Cambrian fauna whether similar morphologies were due to convergent evolution or direct evolutionary relationships. For example, some Ediacaran morphologies suggest relationships to periphera or cnidaria. Peripherans are sponges and cnidarians are corals and jellies and such. And all of these groups shown on the screen right now are Ediacaran biota. And as we can see, some of these, especially this one over here to the right, bear resemblance to the modern animal phylum cnidaria. That is, it looks like a coral or a particular life stage of sea jelly. And so a lot of people are calling this a potential early cnidarian, or the first cnidarian that we see in the rock record, but we're still uncertain of whether that actually is the case and it later evolved into the cnidaria we find in the Cambrian, or whether it was an early animal that bared resemblance morphologically to modern cnidaria or later Cambrian cnidaria, but is unrelated in terms of evolutionary lineage. We also see that other groups like Kimberella, shown here, look an awful lot like a type of mollusk, and other groups look like arthropods, like we saw on the previous slide with Springina, looking a lot like trilobites. And we even have this guy over here, Claudina, which I've seen be interpreted as kind of looking like this series of cups that might have been a coral-like kind of structure and animal, or may have even been a worm-like annelid. We don't know. So from all of this knowledge about the Ediacaran biota and lack thereof, this means that some Ediacarans may be ancestors to modern animals, while others may represent lineages that went extinct in the Cambrian or just before due to being replaced by the explosion of Cambrian life. In other words, it was a mixture of early animal ancestors and failed evolutionary experiments. But the Ediacaran period doesn't begin until 635 million years ago, and Rachel, at the beginning of the video, you said there was a potential animal that evolved 900 million years ago. Well, I'm getting there. Apparently, combined genetics, biomarker, and potential fossil data indicates that sponges, periphera, which are a modern lineage of animal, may have evolved around 700 to 900 million years ago. Now, let me emphasize, with rocks this old, preservation is never that great. So obviously, you can see that our interpretation of these fossils as sponge spicules, which I should preface this, sponges are made up of these little tiny, sometimes silica, sometimes calcium carbonate spicules, which are these kind of, well, they can be shaped in all sorts of ways. I have a whole video about sponge classification, morphologies, etc. I'll link it up here for your reference if you're interested. Anyway, the interpretation of this fossil is obviously, you know, should be taken with a grain of salt, but we do know that, as I discussed in many previous videos about what finally allowed animals to evolve on Earth, oxygen levels in the ocean around 900 million years ago would have been still very low, which would have prevented a lot of types of animals from living in those conditions. However, sponges are one group of animal, which, you know, this is one reason we think they're so primitive and they're one of the earliest animal groups that we find in the rock record. Sponges are really special because they can tolerate very low to no oxygen for certain amounts of time in the water column. And that is a really special ability that sponges, certain types of sponges have. So very primitive sponges may have evolved nearly 900 million years ago. And then obviously, once we get into the Ediacaran period, around 580 million years ago, we had the Avalon explosion with Ediacaran biota proliferating along with the already present sponges. But why then? Was the timing of this explosion just a coincidence, or did something trigger the proliferation of large multicellular animal life? Well, this brings me to my favorite part of this video, which has to do with Snowball Earth. If you aren't aware, two global glaciations called the Sturtian and Marinoan glaciations that occurred around 700-ish million years ago are together known as the Cryogenian Snowball Earth. Why? Because they occurred in the Cryogenian period just before the Ediacaran period. And this event is called Snowball Earth because it covered Earth in ice nearly completely for about 70 million years. And we used to just assume that life survived despite the Snowball Earth events, but now we think that maybe these horrible conditions may have sparked multicellularity. Several groups of multicellular life independently radiated and proliferated at this time, including animals, green algae, red algae. And to understand how Snowball Earth might have induced animal evolution, we have to first introduce a concept called viscosity, which I've covered in my, ironically, igneous petrology videos. You wouldn't think that igneous petrology would have much to do with ancient life, but just hear me out. Viscosity is a liquid's resistance to flow. So honey is more viscous than water because it's less flowy. And temperature strongly controls viscosity. Higher temperature magmas and lavas have a lower viscosity and vice versa, meaning that if they're higher temperature, they're more flowy. They're more like water than honey. But this temperature affecting viscosity concept also applies to other liquids, including water. So during that Snowball Earth period of 70 million years of freezing conditions with nearly global ice cover, there was a fourfold increase in water viscosity of the ocean. Unicellular organisms living in this viscous water were limited in their ability to move and acquire nutrients. So multicellularity may have evolved to overcome this viscosity-induced metabolic deficit. Moreover, multicellularity has evolved many times in Earth's history and easily evolves due to experimental selective pressures in labs. And so this brings up the question, if multicellularity is so easy to evolve, why did modern multicellular lineages take so long to diversify in the Cambrian explosion after the origin of eukaryotic cells, the ones that eventually became the multicellular organisms, potentially as early as 2 billion years ago? The Snowball Earth multicellularity hypothesis suggests that prolonged selective pressures of Snowball Earth may have been the trigger. So essentially, life had to evolve multicellularity to acquire nutrients at a time when mobility was extremely restricted in highly thick and viscous water. And or the early multicellular organisms like sponges and other early multicellular life or algae that evolved just before the Cryogenian Snowball Earth had the advantage when it came to nutrient acquisition during the Snowball Earth period, leading to more proliferation of those types of organisms during and after those events. After the Snowball Earth or Earths subsided and warm seas returned, the novelty of multicellularity permitted these organisms to essentially take over. So they were beneficial during the time of Snowball Earth due to the viscous waters. And then afterwards, life was like, oh, this is great for all sorts of reasons. Let's just do more of this. And it did. As a final note on this video, I want to emphasize that the Ediacaran period wasn't even an official period until 2004. And so this emphasizes the novelty of this research and all that's left to uncover. And so if you are a student or aspiring student or researcher or want to go back to school and look into this stuff, I highly encourage you to do so. There's so much still left to discover about these early animals, about our animal origins, which is so incredible. So yeah, please go into it. And with that, thank you again for watching, and I will see you guys in the next one. Bye.